Welcome back, guys, to the Bear Podcast Show, episode 16, with me, Sean Scullion, a.k.a. The Handsome Stranger, Owen Mallon, a.k.a. The Bear, Aiden Behind the Scenes, and today our guest is Rhys McKee, Cage Warrior Champion. Welcome, Rhys.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here and chat to you both.
Jesus. So, Rhys, the Skeletor.
So they say.
And we, the big belt here, Jesus Christ. So, Rhys, we thank you very much for coming up. We're going to jump in and find out the going-ons, and everyone sees now the belt and sees the glory here, but we're going to dig into the gritty bits and the back work and how it all started. So let's just take it right from the start.
Well, hold on a wee second. We'll just jump in there, because do you want to say to Rhys what you said coming out the road in the van?
What did you say?
His words were, he says, "Say that Rhys boy gives me any lip, I'm going to chop the head of him."
No. Aiden told me, you know, in some podcasts, some of the martial arts experts put them to sleep. And I was like, Jesus, I wouldn't do that to him with only 5 weeks to go to his fight.
As I said, anyone, if you're going to say that, you may bring a big stick in the back of the van.
Hey, and you know the funny thing? Do you ever see that picture of like Mike Tyson and Daniel Cormier together? And they're like, what'll shock you is one of these guys in a street fight would absolutely kill the other. Yeah. And it ain't Mike Tyson. You know, you put him in a hold and he'd be fucking out. Yeah. But for the people out there, so you're a mixed martial arts expert. You're a world champion. So how did it all start, Rhys?
I mean, like any kid in Northern Ireland, I tried to kick a football about a pitch for a few years. Played at a relatively low level, under 15, under 16. And just during a pre-season, got like dragged into this MMA club by my brother. Wanted to get fit for the pre-season, probably just looking for a new kind of something to try and be good at. And it was MMA, so we contacted the local club. Went in there, got our ass kicked a few times, and, you know, just fell in love with it. Like, it's a weird thing to fall in love with, but like, it was an addiction for me, because, you know, at 16 I never realized how powerful I was. You know, I couldn't defend myself really in a situation, and not that I needed to ever, but I think it was the realization that if I was in trouble, that I'm pretty snookered here. So I think I got the bug there, and, you know, once you start learning a few techniques and stopping people being able to do stuff in the gym, like, that there was very addictive early.
You must have played like Vinnie Jones, that they thought would take you to the UFC or over to mixed martial arts. But tell me, Rhys, that, and I've spoke to a lot of ones, I have a massive passion for combat sports, and I think some of them were saying it was very similar to like when people used to say, why would you play rugby? And I'd be like, have you ever had an adrenaline dump from being hit? It's weird. It's a weird thing to explain to somebody. Feeling under pressure, or really putting yourself in a position where you think you're going to run away, like putting yourself in a fight or flight position and coming out, and you feel afterwards when you're like, I got stuck in there, that I didn't know that. You learn something about you that you didn't know when you put yourself in that position.
Like, you know, I remember it very well. Like, our street in Ballymena, where the gym is, there's like a corner where you can kind of peek around the gym. And I remember my first day sparring, like, I was like peeking around, like waiting for the green light to go in. Although it wasn't like that, but in my head it was like, you know, you can only walk in at a certain time. And I remember peeking around, being like a 16-year-old kid. And I walked in, and, you know, there was no young ones there. Like, this was a sparring day. Nobody there. I was like, this is just a bad day for me. Like, I could have went home. But like one of the men at the time, like, took me under their wing and like got a few rounds and stuff. And I remember feeling then like the most empowered, like feeling like this is insane. Although, like, again, got my ass kicked, but like, you know. And I remember that was just like a real like adrenaline kind of dump moment. What you talk about when I was in the fire of it, when I was in, you know, what I felt I was given as good as I got, I absolutely wasn't. But, you know, it was just so powerful. Like, it's class feeling.
But see the way you're saying there, but you get into MMA, obviously, to be fit to defend yourself, mm-hmm. but you never had to. Mm-hmm. Did you find, whenever you get into MMA, that people started then trying to challenge you?
You know, like, this is probably one of the most common questions I get. People think if I was to go out in a night out, that people are squaring up with me left, right and centre. Never got it.
Never.
Never ever got it. And especially in our culture, like, I'm so surprised that, you know.
No, I seen your last fight and I'm like, fuck that.
I'm so surprised. Like, I mean, you get jabs and jokes, but like, kind of nothing that I would call.
Aye, but they're smart. They're smart, but if
backhand comments, you know, like, but like, you know, oh, sure, you're lucky I'm not, whatever, blah blah blah. But I've never really been challenged or been made to back anything up.
Jeez, I found it totally opposite. I used to do a bit of kickboxing. Not that it was any good, but he came second
in every fight.
Smart ass. But I found that. I found whenever you were going out the weekend, boys just coming up and kind of started out.
I've heard it from so many people, like even people I train with. Mm-hmm. I think, I mean, I can only assume maybe it's how I...
But you're a big man. You know, you're a tall man too. Like, it's
what are you trying to say?
But what I'm saying is, you know, maybe people are like, seeing TV and be like, fucking no bar to me. Like, you know, and then the next thing they're standing there and they're like, you know what? Fucking let it go tonight.
I think I'm very like, I have a weird like sense of humor, probably like a really dry sense of humor, where like if someone said like, if someone come and goes, oh, I'm going to take your head off, I'd be like, ah, you know what? You probably would. And just leave. Like, that's kind of really weird to deal with. Like, yeah. Rather than me being like, what did you say? You know, it's just not me.
And you know what? Like, I genuinely, that'd be a viral video. Somebody coming up, giving you shit and getting absolutely put to sleep. But, you know, I know he's saying that, but actually a lot of people, it's great that people are so well aware now of mixed martial arts and they would know you now. It's a good icebreaker. People, you know, it gives you people something to say. And Jesus, seen your last one for a player. You know, you get, of the dickheads that Sean would say one or two, you're bound to get serious people,
you know,
coming up to you. And
you know what? Let's see if we go out in Belfast for dinner or pretty much kind of anywhere in the country within reason. You know, like you'll have people that'll be like, oh, you know, good luck in the next one, or, you know, I seen your last one, or whatever it may be. And most of the time you get really awkward people staring, like in a food aisle where they're like, oh, is that your boy with the funny ears? But like on the ollie, everyone's so nice and supportive, and especially coming up or after a fight is crazy. You know, it's really, it's nice and it's warm.
So you headlined in Belfast. We just don't, but you headlined in Belfast, you know, when you're that 16-year-old peeking in and you're saying thing, you're coming out. Like, I know people say this here, right? But my mind would run a million miles an hour. I remember the first time I went to rugby tonight, I thought I was going to play for Ireland. Mm-hmm. But the reality and the thing, but after that, like, it's a pinch moment too. And I suppose you're that much about the business, because I know people are saying the pinch moment, but you're that much in training. That's another fight, and it's more expectation. People you know from down your roads coming and seeing you, like, I can't get fucking knocked out of here. You know, there must be more the business saying. Now remember they always say the A is easy to get, it's harder to keep. You know, it's now every time the expectations on you.
You know, and it's a thing that's followed me my whole career, especially kind of being younger than the most of the guys I fought for a lot of my career. It's like, they all talk about the pressure. Oh, there's this massive pressure. Like, I'm a natural born show off. And like, I think anybody that's doing what I do for a living is a natural born show off. Like, there's nobody in the world that would want to stand in front of a crowd of 10,000 people and fight someone unless they like a bit of the intention. And like, I was really uncomfortable saying that for so much of my career. Like, of course we love the attention. Like, why else would, like, I could go do something and work behind the scenes and it'd be fine and that'd be great. But like, I like the attention. So when people say the pressure word, I'm like, it's just a bullshit word for me. Like, I just, like, the bigger the stakes and the more pressure in me is the better race you're going to get. So when I was in Belfast and, you know, 250 people coming up from Ballymena, you know, in an arena of 7,000 people, world title against a guy that nobody else wanted to fight, like, I genuinely slept like a baby. Not a bit of pressure on my shoulders.
But them butterflies are bound to be unreal.
Oh, like, I mean, you know, you're walking out, we stayed in the Europa, you know, walking around Belfast and people are like, again, the good luck tomorrow night, and like stop and getting photos with you and stuff before the fight. Like, you know, that is like a moment, like even, you know, fighting in the MGM in Vegas or wherever it may be in future years, like fighting and headlining in Belfast for world title will be hard to top.
There is no audience like here in Northern Ireland. I don't care what you say. We went to Windsor for Frampton Fury was fighting, and it was the weird race. It has to be the weirdest culture clash I've ever seen in my life. So you had Paddy Barnes, we had the Falls, the guys from the Falls, and then you had Cahir Frampton, you had Tigers Bay, and then you had Travellers. And I was like, this is one old big cauldron, and everyone just singing and roaring. It was you know, everyone always talks about, you know, the stigma and thing, but sports are wild, like from years, even back to Birmingham, it's a wild defining where we just love basically combat.
Especially combat, like, you know, you always heard Joe Rogan saying it best on one of his podcasts. He said, you know, if you go back to your years at school and stuff, and, you know, if there was a football over here, rugby over there, and a fight broke out in the corner, everybody bailed and ran to the fight. We just have a natural, love for fighting. Like, yeah, wherever you're a fight fan or not, like, you're still going to go watch it, but I wonder who won, or,
yeah,
you know, so sport in this country definitely brings people together. I was there that night. It was the wettest night ever.
Oh, I was
soaked. I'm still soaked from it.
But tell me then, Rhys, they're becoming so much more knowledgeable too about, because like, if you only flick over to MMA, it does look like a brawl.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the first time I was watching, I was like, what the fuck's going on here? And I didn't really like a lot of the wrestling, but now the more and more I watch it, the more and more I get into it, the more you start understanding and the movement and how they're defending moves. And it's like a game of chess. It really is.
It's
like
a game of human chess.
Like,
yeah,
you see them moving to block something that, and you're like, fuck, oh, that was, you know, that mm-hmm. was a good move. And like, people are becoming more knowledgeable. Like, they're applauding things like that mm-hmm. now. They're getting more into it, yeah, and they're following it more. And like, we're obviously going to touch on the Conor McGregor thing. Like, you can't deny it. Anywhere you go in MMA, no matter what happened, I'd say for 10 years, it's like Jonah Luma of rugby.
Mm-hmm.
Something comes along and changes the stakes. It gives it the glamour. And then all of a sudden, the rest of the people, like, you totally see what UFC grew by. You see now where people are watching it and thing. But how many gyms are rooting up around Northern Ireland, or how many boxing gyms are now bringing in mixed martial arts because of it?
It's ridiculous. Like, he puts kids in gyms. He puts people like me in podcasts like this. You know, it's like the compound effect of him doing what he done and being as loud as he was at the time, and it's unbelievable. Like, without McGregor, I feel like I genuinely probably feel we'd probably wouldn't be having a conversation. Like, that's how much deep work I think he's done. You know, unbelievable. Like, you know, despite your opinion on him, and he has done some wrongs and he's done a lot of rights, like, he's done a hell of a lot for the sport in the country.
I was over UFC.
Oh, I was a massive fan of his. And then, see, once all that crap started going on, I just disliked him so much.
I still find it hard not.
You'll always watch him, though.
I don't know what way to put this. I don't agree with the shit, and I genuinely don't. But still, when you watch back the entertainment, the show, let's get it right. Showtime Boxing, Showtime Combat, Showtime MMA. Mm-hmm. It's the show that comes first. It's mm-hmm. the business, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There's so many, and especially, like, I look and you see the likes of Khabib, who's that good, right? But genuinely, other than pure, probably won't remember him that well after, if he hadn't fought McGregor.
Mm-hmm.
But because that is the crack. If you don't put the show, like, I'll tell you better than that. Boxers are all giving off about YouTube boxers, mm-hmm. man. Guys, if you don't have a personality, and I understand this, you've dedicated your craft and you're fighting at a different level. People want to see these people more than you. Mm-hmm. They're paying more than you. You need to ask why, if you're better at it, why they don't want to see you.
For sure.
It's the personality. It's 100%. The show. But like, who, you know, you're going to see the likes of probably Garcia and Davis fighting, right? They might not get the same views as Tommy Fury.
They definitely won't.
And you got to ask why people are like, and they're giving off. And I can understand this because you know this. Mm-hmm. The dedication and the stuff that you have to give up from 16, like when people are going off to parties and they're going off when they're 18 mm-hmm. and they're doing all the things that you can't yeah. fucking do. And to get where, and you get a small window of your shot mm-hmm. if you get it.
Mm-hmm.
Where these guys have rocked up making fucking Flickr videos one way, and then the next thing they're making multi-million pounds. But I said this, I'd seen, I don't know whether it was Carl Frampton or someone had tweeted and about it, and I was like, but you gotta ask yourself mm-hmm. why.
Yeah.
It's the show. These guys are understand very, very clever people. Jake Paul's extremely intelligent. Mm-hmm. He knows exactly what he's doing. He knows how to market himself. He knows to put himself in the position.
Mm-hmm.
Floyd Mayweather has made more money while he's been retired than he did when he boxed, and he's had no risk of getting beat. He's fighting these mm-hmm. thing. But we'll go back to more serious. Your first fight, where did you?
I fought in the Everglades in Derry. And I remember, so I was training just kind of like just innocent training. And when I say innocent, it wasn't for anything. There was no real, and I was just seeing where this thing went. And I remember seeing Rodney and another coach at the time. He was like, they were whispering about, like, you know, when you know someone's whispering about you, it was like that. And then they called me over, like, ushered me over and said, like, do you fancy, you know, a run out? A run out is obviously a fight. And I was like, you know, at the time, just you know, the thought of like letting someone down. So I was like, yeah, no problem. And I think it all went really good, like, up until the moment I fought. Like, you know, so I felt all like, this is class, this is exactly what I signed up for. But I must have forgot somewhere in the process that I had to fight someone, you know. Like, I genuinely must have, because I remember I get in that cage, Like, I never used to, like, the lights were so bright. I had no t-shirt on for the first time. I never experienced that. You don't dream, but you dream about a t-shirt, obviously. And it was just so different. I had the wee gloves on instead of the boxing gloves. And, like, everything was just so foreign. Long story short, it lasted 90 seconds and I got choked and I was never as glad till to get out of that cage and back down the road. But, like, again, cried like a baby and backstage and just knew I would be back. And I remember one of my corner men at the time, Ryan Boydy, at the time, he like ripped me off. He was like, well, he says this now. He didn't tell me at the time. Of course, I was a 16-year-old kid crying, but he said, like, I never fought, like, at that time. I thought that was you done. You'd never been back in the gym. And I just had, like, a bat out of hell then. And I think that's probably what made me obsessed. And it was probably the embarrassment, you know, of how it went. Not that it went that bad, but just not a great moment.
There's people that would just buckle up and go home.
100%. And, you know, I think even at the time, like, my parents at the time and family, and our parents at the time were still parents, like, I think at that time, like, it was, you know, very much like, you know, you don't have to do this, you know, there's plenty you can do and go back to football and whatever.
Parents, that's it.
But I just knew, like, I need that feeling of, like, choking someone out in front of a crowd. And it's just like, see, then when I went and got my next win, it was like, flip it, like that one of that feeling, I still don't know if I can top that. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's like that first win, like you feel like the baddest man on the planet. Like, I mean, you're not the baddest man on the planet, but like it felt unbelievable. So,
but even good. Your fights now, you're bound to still be learning. You know, you're going back to that first fight where it was over 90 seconds, mm-hmm. and you learned from that and you moved on.
100%.
I've no doubt you're still learning, like, things about yourself from how till.
Like that, like I trained last night and there's a few mistakes I done last night and I'm like, right, well, I'm training tonight, I'll not do that. You know, it's a constant learning job, and I think the day you stop learning is definitely the day you should be done. But it's a learning game, and you know, you learn more from losses than wins, kind of. But I think you learn from absolutely everything you do. From the drive here, probably learn, you know what I mean? It's that you learn about everything in life, and I think that's a philosophy of martial arts, but it's important.
See, the mixed martial arts, you know what I enjoy about it? See, in boxing, a record is wild important. And obviously it is important. But I mean, you know, it's such an intricate sport that a loss doesn't define you in the way that, I mean, like, you know, it can happen.
You lose your own boxing, like, oh my goodness. Like,
it's a massive thing.
Put that boy in the dump, like, yeah. He's done. You know, it's like, and that's why boxing's so, like, kind of, like, bullshit in a way at times, and I love boxing, like boxing's class, but like
fighting journeyman on the way up, and
the best don't fight the best. Yeah, like, no. You know, how many good fights over the years have we missed? Yeah. Because
we're in the middle of it now. Yeah. I genuinely, and I'll touch on this, I love boxing too, but I never thought I would say this, but I don't think Fury wants the USAC fight at the minute. Mm-hmm. The way I'm looking at it, like, your man's just agreed to 70-30 purse, and they pulled it again today. It says today that it's been
pulled.
So I don't know, maybe it's a game for money and build it up.
And Tyson, like, he doesn't remind you of someone that has that same mindset.
Yeah.
You know, but like, yeah, it'll be sad if we miss that one as well.
Aye, and like, I think, the Joshua and him danced about each other, and that should have been done.
Like, yeah, that one should have been done years ago.
But, you know, going fighting Dylan White for the third time when there's fights out there, or Chisora, and like, you're like, right, Deontay Wilder, I would watch that if they fought again. I'd literally watch that because Deontay Wilder could knock you out in an instant. So there's always that excitement, no matter how he's battering him. But we're saying there, the O isn't, well, I'm going off to how I love it, but the O's not, as you say, like they have says, you can learn from your losses, you know.
No, in MMA, the best fight the best. And that's from early days. Like, you know, I remember being an amateur and my record was maybe like, 8-0 at the time, and they put me up against another guy, Deggy from Newry at the time, 9-0, and like we were scheduled to fight, although it didn't happen, whatever. But like, even from young amateurs, like, you're gonna fight the best amateur in the country, and we're gonna find out who's the best. Maybe it's just, you know, the nature of the, I don't know, maybe the sport did have a bit more of a gruesome beginning,
yeah,
where it was more prize fighting in terms of the term cockfighting and stuff, but like maybe the bit that was built to find out who's the best, and it's just kept that kind of
it's aggressive.
Yeah,
there's more, there is, and like I know they can say this, but I think there's less hiding. I know boxers would definitely not agree with. There's less hiding space in a cage than, you know, in a ring.
Well, if you're in boxing, you're getting KO'd with mm-hmm. one of these two tools. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You're getting choked out. You're getting a knee. You're mm-hmm. getting a kick. You're getting...
Boy, I could take you down and lie on you for 15 minutes. And, you know, it's just... Yeah. It's... Yeah, there's no secrets. There's no hiding place. There's no... It's just mad. Sometimes you think about it, you're like, why did I even do that?
But and you know what? Logically, when you sound this out, you're like, it's a fucking modern day gladiator. Why would I do this? Why would I? But mm-hmm. like, it for thousands of years, the bloodthirsty people want to watch it. People want to do it.
It's in us, like, you know.
But so you moved on. Where did you make the progression from when you're fighting amateur and then said, you know what, I want to make a career of this? Because there. It's not an easy career. It's mm-hmm. not like, you know, if you do go into boxing and you start getting titles, there's, you know, slowly getting there that MMA is becoming that way, but it's not the same where, the, you know, you start getting your money shot. It takes a long time to build it up, doesn't it?
Like, I was 5-0 as a pro before I even thought about doing it as a career. I actually won my first world title, so this is my second. I had a world title when I was 23, and that was the first time I even thought, like, this is even... on the cuff of a career. I remember, so I've worked throughout all my career, like I was working at a bus factory in Ballymena and got the world title, just won it, and then went back on the Monday and texted my coach, and I was like, I think I could maybe, you know, do the PT and thing, the whole personal training, you know, take people a bit of pads, piss off at 1 o'clock in the day, go home, live the it's just not like that. But and that was the first moment I thought it was a career. But up until that, I never had. You know, I wanted to fight people and wanted to eventually fight for titles, but it was all, like, it was never really on purpose. I didn't sit down as a 16-year-old and write, I want to be the UFC champion or I want to be a millionaire free fighting. Like, never done any of that. Like, it was all kind of, like, one at a time. And then once I got to the stage of world title, I was like, I think I could do something better during the day than working a bus factory and with chemicals and stuff. So that was, if I'm being brutally honest, that was the first time I seen it as a career. To be honest.
And then, so did you make that move then? Did you decide?
Yeah, I left the job, wrote a really bad handwritten note in the toilets, and went to the line manager, and he said, right, you have a 2 weeks notice. I said, yep, no problem, never in again, never done. And that was it. So just, that was my last, like, full-time job.
Did that up the ante?
I mean, it did, but I always took it serious. Like, when I was working in that place, I started at 7 to 4, so I was up training at 5:30 in the morning, going to work, then training after. When I left the job, I trained at 9:30, took a lie-in, and trained after. So there wasn't much different, bar the like crap part of the middle of the day. But it definitely did up the ante. Like, you know, it raised the stakes. You know, there's more on it. And if I'm being totally honest, I didn't like it at the start. It was all in. Like, there was nothing, you know, people say the yin to yang and all. I had no yang. It was just yin and yang. Like, I was training all the time. And like, I actually feel I was in a really bad place at the time with it, because it was just too much. So find another, like, things in my life, like part-time jobs, and, you know, went after the coaching a bit more and stuff, and at that time it filled the void and brought the equilibrium back.
And then where then, so you were world champion at that point?
Yep.
And then when did you decide to pursue that you were going to get this back?
So we'll try and make this a bit shortened version. So I won the title of a guy in Dublin, lost it the next fight in Belfast, and then recouped my career, had like fights in between, blah blah blah. That promotion shut down.
Who was that promotion?
That was a promotion we called Bama.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
So they were Bama, and they were great. I love Bama. Fought like my first maybe 8 or 9 pro fights with them, and then they folded. I went to Cage Wars, known to be a feeder show for the UFC. So then that was very much in my mind, because I knew if I got that, then it'd be UFC time. So had a few wins with Cage Warriors, like good wins, you know, good finishes. And then lockdown happened, and that was that next stage of my career.
Mm-hmm. It's 3 years or 2 years with lockdown. Mm-hmm. It's a big window in a professional fighter's career.
Totally. Like,
you know, when things, and I know Fight Island happened for UFC, and that's all right, because they were a massive organization and they could make that happen. Mm-hmm. But for you then, what did that mean?
So, like,
gyms are closed as well, aren't
they? I'll be honest, like, I went in, you know, when lockdown was rumoured, I was like, I'll be fine, I'll be training. And in this stage I had I had a gym, so like I can a commercial gym, not like a, but like I still had a place to train. I still had a place for headspace and, you know, stay fit and stuff. I done not a thing for like, you know, 3 or 4 months, and that was fine until my manager gave me a call and told me I was going to Fight Island to fight. So that was my, like, I kind of caught napping a wee bit. You know, it was great to sign for the UFC. It was that was class, but then I went in and fought Shamayev on literally 6 days' notice. And I mean,
what a fighter to get to, like.
Oh man, like, and I would, like, I genuinely would have used, this isn't my excuse, because if I won, this would be the first thing I would have told people, that yeah. I didn't train at all, bar like the 6 days before it. Went in and fought him, and it was, I mean, it was a learning lesson, and it was fun, and but
did you feel like you were three in the deep end? No,
100% now. But like, you know, you can be three in the deep end when you dive in. You know, like if I text you today and say, I have this opportunity for you, do you want to do it? And you say yes, and you come like, you're a dick, you shouldn't have offered me that opportunity. You know what I mean? It's, I want it. I very much wanted it. And
it might not come back around.
It might not. And if you say no, it's definitely not going to come back around. So, you know, like, I didn't go there to lose either. You know, yeah. I wasn't there as a volunteer. As I say to people, like, some people say, oh, you were mad.
But can I ask you this here? And this is what I was thinking. Some of these fighters are saying, oh, they got these short notice fights, right? You know, the likes of Hamza Chimaev, he's getting a very well-rooted title fight. All of a sudden, some of these fighters that they've been watching, and Dana White's been watching, and that you know, that they've good social media, and they're obviously good fighters, they're getting, all of a sudden, they're getting fights, and they're pulling people on a couple of weeks' notice. Do you not think it's not, because definitely not, you weren't a journeyman by any means, but what I mean is, they're pulling people in and catching them napping, because they want these push through.
Absolutely.
They need these fighters up at the top level. Like,
absolutely.
Some of them are getting their shot quicker than they should. If like, there's people standing going mad, but they're just not that much of a show or a draw. Mm-hmm. So, you know, because I was watching that, and like, you know, where would that leave you, the UFC? Because you didn't get to give an account to yourself.
Yeah, so I had two fights. You know, I had the one fight with Shamayev, and they 100% do catch people cold, by the way, of course. You're telling me I'm the only person in the world that said yes. I mean, if so, then pretty cool. But I mean, I just somehow doubt it. You know, they probably knew we weren't training. I didn't know if that's real or not, but maybe. But so I went in there and then fought. That was in November. And I was very quick to be like, we're still on lockdown at this stage, so I'm still not really training, just doing bits. That time I got a elite pass to train. You know, so like in the country, technically, I was one of the only people that were allowed to fully train, which was still not great because nobody else can train. You know, bar your two training partners, which one was a coach and one was a padman, so it's not fantastic. I was very eager to get another fight. So I fought from July, and then my second USC one was in November, and it wasn't ideal either. I took COVID 2 weeks before the fight, or 3 weeks before the fight, trained in the living room for a week or 8 days, and then flew out to Vegas and fought Alex Morano. At that time had 13 USC fights, I think. And we had a great fight, like a 3-round fight, you know, back and forth. I fought a bit emotional. I wanted it so bad. That was my biggest downfall. You know, every punch I hit him, like if it landed, it would have been a home run, and the right ones just didn't land. So that was coming up to Christmas, which was a nice time to find out you get released. And I remember Graham texting me, and he's just like, good and bad news. And the bad news was the only news, really. There was no good news in it, bar the silver lining, I suppose. But I was just saying, like, it's not going to be the UFC for now, so I was a better pill to swallow.
But that's bound to be hard as well, because it was obviously during COVID.
Okay.
And no crowd there to spur you on. And
so different, like, yeah. So, you know, and I'm not one of these people, like, if anybody give me bad news, I just don't really react. Like, I'm not emotional, or, you know, I'm pretty, like, I accept what happened. But, like, that was shit. It was a crap moment, but I just knew, like, nothing I can do. Like, there's nothing I can do. All I can do is what I do now. So for a few months, I'd literally done nothing. I said, I trained, but I said, I'm not fighting until COVID's away. And I stuck true to that word. Like, I didn't fight until everything cleared up.
I'm trying to remember his name, Scotch fighter, that he had the same problem. He went to the UFC and he fought in the Ultimate Fighter Championship, and then he went and fought for that £1 million fight.
Oh, Brandon Loughnan.
So he, like, the beauty about mixed martial arts now, it's not only the one shot.
Mm-hmm.
And like, and even you hear Paddy the Body saying that his biggest paid fights weren't in his first round of UFC. It's not the option, but when you get there and you don't get to give the count you want and then it's taken away, it'd be easy to throw the toys in and say, fuck it, I'm out.
For sure, and I said in the corner room, or after the Murano fight in Vegas, I was like, I'm not going to have cage wars again. I'm sitting here with the belt now. But at that time, I was just like, no, I'm just not going back there. Like, I had a feeling I'd be cut and nobody else believed me, but lo and behold, it was. You definitely have these options, you know, where, like, you know, you could go live. I could never get punched in the face again.
Yeah.
Like, that's a pretty easy and viable and understandable option. Like, I don't think anybody would look at you, but, like, I knew you had to write that story again. If genuinely believe this to you, or, like, I say this with every ounce of my body, like, if I don't feel I can get to the UFC again, I'll just walk away. I'll just do, not, like, that's where I want to get to. I don't do anything to not reach the top. And that's why I'm doing everything I'm doing now.
And the beauty of that is the way the UFC works, if there's a show in London or a show, you could literally just get a call tomorrow. Like, they could say, the only thing this time I'd say you wouldn't be as caught as napping as no. You know, you'd be ready for it, because that is the way they come and that is the way they try and catch gold. But also on the flip side, how many people have got their break in UFC because they've come in on a short notice and they've chinned whoever it was totally. That was supposed to be getting their run, and they've ended their hype train and now all of a sudden
And like, I'm the perfect fighter for the UFC. Like, all my 12 wins, 12 finishes, you know, UFC love finishers. Like, it's a big style of my fight. So, and I know when I get that shot, and, you know, with a reasonable prep, I'll never be caught cold again though.
Yeah.
I'll never, you know, I'm in a two win streak after the UFC now. This one 100% is the cement to get my place back in. And
how long is it since you fought?
Last June, I had the 29 stitches in my forehead.
It was a fucking war, that, wasn't
it? Yeah, crazy, yeah. But so it was last June, and it'll be April when I fight again, so fair run, like, fair run, but needed as well. I had a bad shoulder injury in between, and rehab process and stuff to done. It's a rough game, as I'm sure you're aware.
Yeah, yeah.
You'll be ready to rock and roll now.
Yeah, now's the time.
So who's up in the cards?
Yeah, so we're fighting Jimmy Wallhead. So he's the interim title. I'm sure you know what interim means, but for anyone listening, that's interim is when the champion can't defend, so they put an interim. It's basically a number one contender fight, and I'm not really sure why they go to the hassle of giving someone else a belt, and when they could just call it a number one contender fight. Maybe that's just me being cheeky, but I genuinely don't see the point of just calling it a number one contender fight. So he's interim champion, I'm the champion, and we fight to unify to see who the real one is, but there's only one, and we all know.
There's one, and there's a pretender.
And there's only room in the throne for one. Do you know what I mean? It's true.
Where's the fight?
Dublin, fighting in the Free Arena. So it's my third headline in Ireland. The headline Cork, Belfast, and now Dublin. So on the full tour.
What way, Rhys, does your following cross the border? What way do you find it in Dublin?
You know what? Unbelievable. I think I maybe have more of a following in...
I massively believe that. They love MMA. Like.
I maybe have more of a following in Dublin. I've fought a lot of my career in Dublin and in the same arena. You know, a lot of people talk about, you know, Jimmy. Jimmy's he's 39 now. He's, you know, he's wore the t-shirt twice. He's done his full tour. He's been in the UFC, Bellator, everywhere. And they're all talking about his perfect retirement. You know, this is all coming to a close and it's coming to the top. Listen, I have my own story to write here.
This fucking party's getting spoiled.
100%, but this is my party. I'm going back to the Free Arena, the same arena I made my pro debut in. This is my sixth fight in this arena. Like,
yeah, it's my home.
This is my story here, you know. So I've got my fairy tale to write.
Brilliant. And, you know, we're talking there. Tell me, You're such a chilled out. You're just a chilled out guy. Like, and I'm seeing you've taken, obviously that hurt, and you're going back, and you're in lockdown, and that hurts. But to get yourself back there and that hunger and to go in, but you don't seem like it gets to you. No matter what they're talking about or what they want to say, it doesn't seem like it gets to you. You don't get involved in much shit talk or back and forth.
Very vanilla, aren't they?
Until you get punched in the face, but you know, which is a good thing. But then you said you fought an emotion, which we know is a bad thing. That you do, you never want to be you fucking punch yourself out, and you know, when. But that's the stakes too. That's like, where you're at. You
like get, I definitely like I'm a fighter's fighter, and I'm not sure he was a UFC at the weekend. The fighter Justin Gaethje, And people always talk about Justin Gaethje. He's one of them fighters that can't avoid an action-filled fight. And, and that's me.
He wants to stand to it, even if he's leading every round.
That is it. Like, so I think I'm a yin-to-yang fighter. It's like, I can be so, like, reserved, and it's not an act. A reserved act compared to everybody else throwing their acts up. But I'm, like, a boring act, maybe. And then, but when I fight, it's just, I'm just a different, cool. I just know I'm a different person. And I just have, like, I have the thrill of competition and the thrill of performing. I just love the game of inches.
But even we were watching back some of your fights there in the office, and we were saying this, like, even the fights that you're hosting, you're still trying to knock, you're still going, which is a dangerous tactic too, you know. And as you know, as the opponent, well, the opponents were good, but as it gets tighter, when you're going for that and you're hunting that, you have a 12-12, is it? 12, mm-hmm. 12 wins, 12 knockouts?
12 finishes.
But that's a... You want to keep chasing, like, you know, you don't want a points factor. You ain't in there for a points factor.
No way. Like,
you don't want somebody else deciding who's winning that fight.
Like, when I win a fight, I want that person that, like, it's going to be a long flight home, you know, it's going to be a long drive home, wherever they have to go. It's like, they're like, I do not want to fight that boy again. That's what I want. And, you know, pumping people cold, there's no argument. There's no argument with that. And, you know, a points fight, like, oh, but I thought I won 2, 3, and 4, and it's... You know, put him to sleep, and what are you going to argue that he fell asleep? Like, yeah. You know, there's just no argument. So I'm a finisher for sure. I just like everything being polished off and signed off.
So what round on the 29th of April?
I think it'll be the 4th. This is a world title fight, so it's 5 fives. I've had the last world title fight didn't go. It was in the 3rd round. So I want to get to the round 4 and 5. I want to get the real trench work, the real... I like it to be as uncomfortable as it can be. And you know, I heard Jimmy saying or in a post or something that he wants to, you know, make it uncomfortable and drag me to the deep waters. It's like, this is like,
that's where I live.
I love to hear it. Like, let's do it, you know.
You ever see Batman? You merely adopted the dog. I was born in it.
You know what? Someone needs to clip me a TikTok and I'll put that on. But like, it's, you know, people, my whole career, people have been saying I'm going to drag a race to deep water, because I like to strike. It's no secret at this stage of my career. You know, I'll drag him to deep water and stuff like that. It's like at least use different lines. At least, you know, I'm going to outclass him here. Fair enough. That you can say that. But to say I'm going to make him that uncomfortable that he's going to quit, it's just not going to happen. Like, you know, I get sliced clean open in the front of Belfast.
How many stitches?
29.
I was actually looking there. They've done a great job.
I had to wait maybe 18 hours to get them, but it was worth it.
I've seen the pictures after, and it was crazy. A Frankenstein job, wasn't it?
Pure Frankenstein job. And I tell you, some looks a few days after that. But that's what I mean. It's like, you can't sicken that old dog. It's like that old dog that hangs about the yard and nobody can get rid of for years. It's, in a way, it's kind of me, you know. It's, you'll just not sicken me. I'll just keep coming.
What, away from fighting and away from thing, what's your chill out? What else?
Well, I mean, I don't really have a chill out. Like, obviously I have a wife. There's no chill out with a wife. It's good fun, you know.
So you train plenty?
Oh, she'll kill me. So I have a wife, have 2 dogs, which is great. It made me re-postpone this podcast. And I run a gym as well. So I own a gym, lucky enough that I have an amazing place in Ballymena. So chill out, there's no real such thing. It's just, what puzzle am I working on that day? You know, there is no chill out.
Brilliant. Well, I'm looking forward to the fight, especially now we feel like we're vested interest racing it, and we'll be championing you on. And you know what? And this is what we were talking about even in this. And I says to you that Sport Unite, there's so many people there that'll be behind your back. What's the plan? What's the plan with Jim? Are you going to train future champs, or is that down the line? Is that something you do once you've stopped putting the gloves on yourself?
Yeah, you know what? I had, so a bit of my gym story, but like I had a gym in a town called Killarea. I'm sure you know where Killarea is. I had like a martial arts gym, and it was good fun, and I was teaching fighters and stuff. Actually, some fighters that had done really well off it, but it was taking away a bit too much for me, and it was kind of making me not love it as much. Because I was like trying to give more than I was even kind of getting myself. So long story short, fast forwarded that, went to like a commercial facility, which, you know, helping more like normal people like get fit, get healthy, get strong. And that's my current project. And that'll be a long, long one, because it's very fun. But I mean, after my career said and done, I'm sure I'll be teaching MMA fighters somewhere, or I'm sure.
I know you don't like to look through fights, and fighters don't. But, you know, when you spoil Jimmy's party, mm-hmm. put him into retirement, Where's the next?
That's UFC next. It's UFC next. 100%. That I'll have two fights this year with the UFC, in my opinion. And I remember I said this in an interview in 2019, and it went viral after. But if I don't make the UFC this year, it'll be a bad year. It'll be a disappointment. So listen, I just need it. 29th of April, I just need to do the job as convincingly as I know I will, and everything else. You know, you can't argue the fight game. Look at Leon Edwards. Leon Edwards was to try to keep him away from the title forever. He kept beating people, and you can't argue someone that keeps winning.
I have to be honest with you about Leon Edwards. And now I know with his coach's corner and the way the Usman fight went in the second one, and they played the Rocky, and it just went completely viral, because it did look like he gave up. It genuinely looked like he gave up.
Yeah, yeah.
It resigned himself to defeat. And even the way the comedy, it all laid in till all of a sudden that head kick. But I was thinking to myself, and this is my own ignorance to it, I was like, Usman's going to do him now, because he's going to be ready for the only thing he had was the, and then I watched it, and I was like,
I can believe it.
I genuinely couldn't believe that he'd done it. And now, to be honest with you, I have to question some of the scoring, because he got a point deducted, and I was like, I need a 2 point. There was a couple of rounds he dropped, and I was like, I thought he was one round ahead, and some of them had him like 2 and 3 up, and I was like, that can't be right.
Yeah, I mean, the judging in the UFC is weird at the minute.
But, like, you talk about, that was a different story.
Unbelievable. Like, people say when you win a title, you become 30% better. Yeah. And, you know, it's the first time I've ever heard that. And, you know, it's probably something I actually agree with when I think about it, because the persona and, you know, it's not an imposter syndrome anymore. It's you're starting to act as what you are. So there's a natural rise of level. And I think Leon showed that. If anybody was to beat Leon, I wanted it to be Kamaru Usman. And if anybody was to beat Kamaru Usman, I wanted it to be Leon.
Kamaru Usman's a different.
I love him. I'm his ultimate fan, but I'm surprised he's not retired, to be honest.
Would you hang it up on that? I don't think that could be his legacy.
Put it this way, if he won, he would have retired.
Aye.
Which is hard, because now he's going to fight someone that's probably not even worthy to fight him. But once he was at the pinnacle, like undoubtedly at the time he was, you know, pound for pound top. And then he took two in a row. It's like, how do you even climb that mountain again?
Well, what, Sean, if obviously we're going to have to try and scout, so I know it's sold out for the 29th, we're going to have to try and scout some tickets for that. But the UFC, like, no matter where it is, like, we'll have to go. Like,
yeah.
And this is the statement, this is telling the wise here right now. Look, you know, I had the man on here. Look, where's Lucky Charm? We're going.
there's
a Vegas fight.
Class. I fought in Vegas, and it wasn't what I needed.
Yeah.
I love Vegas. I got married in Vegas. Love Vegas has my heart, but I need a fight in it when it's real. You know?
Yeah. Because I went out to the McGregor Khabib fight, and the atmosphere and build up was absolutely ridiculous. It got crazy. Like, some of the things that were said got crazy. Like, there was some of the things didn't have to be said. Like, you know, you start going into people's religion and cultures, it fucking gets messy as fuck. But you just have to, the noise. Like, we went to the weigh-in, right? No, the presser was the day before. So we went to the press conference, right? On Pure Yank, the presser the day before. But we went, and it just, the stadium filled. And, like, you could tell that this was different, because, like, the UFC would have had, like, their press conference wouldn't have been done like that. It'd be done in a hotel in a smaller thing. But this was a stadium, and then it filled. And then they went back for the weigh-ins, and it was a show. And, like, I remember Joe Rogan was talking about it in his, and he was like, I've never seen anything like this in my life. He's like, the droves that showed up, roaring and cheering. And this is the thing, especially in Northern Ireland, regardless of religion, Frampton went and fought in New York, and like the people that showed up for him, you know, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You know, you said at the top of the show, we love fighting, like, I love it, like.
Totally, and like,
and no good at it.
Even seeing McGregor at the John Jones weigh-in, like,
it added something to it.
He walked on the stage during someone else's main event weigh-in, and everybody's shaking his hand, and he was hugging the commentator, and it's just the pull that man, like, it's just ridiculous. Like, it's ridiculous.
This is the problem with Reese. Where do you go there, right? Where do you go? Obviously, he's away. There's a wee bit of hissy hits going in there to get the legs back and get it repaired and take time out. But where do you go now for McGregor? Like, the hunger, I don't think that this is 100% true, but I do think once you, you know, you start having that easy life, there's going to be bigger questions. Why do I need to do this? Mm-hmm. But a fighter is a fighter, and he is a fighter. And you have to, the thing that everyone loved about McGregor at the very start was he would fight anybody.
Anyone.
At any weight. Like, you've seen the documentary, you've seen him when he was doing his weight cuts. Jesus Christ, don't get me started on that. I think it's mental. I think it should be done a week before.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know they probably still, but I just mean, like, it's going to happen. There's going to be studies about the damage that's been coming from doing it too close to a fight, too dehydrated and not rehydrated. Like, some people just rehydrate better and quicker and mm-hmm. thing. But anyway, we'll not go into that. But you've seen him, they come to the house and you've seen him in the middle of the week. God, he looked bad. Mm-hmm. And he's like, well, what's that mean? And he's just, you're not thinking right. You're water cutting, you're saying, and he's like, whoever it is, I'll fight them.
Yeah,
I'll fight them. And then people are like, oh, the Diaz fighting. And I was like, there's probably about 20 pound weight of difference in the two of them by the time there was. Didn't give a shit.
Yeah, and so, like, I think he'll never lose that part of him. Like, you know,
a fighter's a fighter,
and especially like from his background, and he's from Crumlin and Dublin, like where, although we're all a fighting country, like they're definitely a fighting country. So I just think his DNA of fighting's too deep.
But that's what I mean. He takes a fight again. And the always was going to be the problem with him was when you talk the talk, you got to walk the walk. You're only as good, and you know this. You know this mm-hmm. in fighting. You're as good as your last one. You start mm-hmm. talking that, and then somebody puts you to fucking sleep.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
And in the style that Khabib done it was wild. Like, you know, I think the way it went with Khabib, that was all right, because I actually thought he fought well. I thought, you know,
yeah.
looking back on it, not at the night, seeing the night in the crowd, there was just this feeling that he wasn't doing well. Mm-hmm. But watching it back, I was like, I actually think he performed well, and he won rounds. He's the first person to take a round. But then, it's different watching at home, you know, but there was a feeling the whole way through it that he wasn't rust. And when he got caught with overhand, you're like, fuck, this is going, this mm-hmm. is, you know, this is not the plan.
Yeah, yeah.
But then, you ever see Snoop Dogg and Kevin Hart doing this? Is fucking brilliant. And he's like, you know, and they're reading out when he broke his fucking leg, and he's like, "You're wasting my days." Like, there's still that part where they'll still show him and they're still clipping. But how do you come back? What do you do there? Because you've all this money. Yeah. You're not there for the money anymore. And no matter what you say, he is a fighting man. But when you're getting a real easy life and you don't need to do this, and you don't, you know, and you, yeah, it's a different hunger. You're not addicted to the money and success, but when you don't need to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and train, mm-hmm. when you're lying on these silk pillows, like, and you're in a Lamborghini yacht, it's a different, how do you get yourself stirred to get back in there where somebody's going to fight you and they know their life, their whole legacy is made if they beat mm-hmm. you. Like,
I think it's the fame tour, though, for him. I think, you know, it is the bravado, the show. I think, you know, will he ever be as hungry as he was at the start? Absolutely not. When he talked about being on, you know, the benefits and stuff at the time, of course he's not going to be the same hunger. But at the same time, he's also in a place of, he's much more comfortable than he's ever been. So, like, you get, you know, a happy fighter is a dangerous fighter. They always say, I bet you Conor McGregor is pretty happy. Like, I'd be pretty happy if I was him. I think the fights doesn't really matter if he wins or loses in a way. Like, I don't think his legacy is ever going to be tarnished now, but I think it's the fame tour. I think, you know, for him now, it's getting as much presence as he can, you know, like just being McGregor and being around it. I don't think the result is as important to him as it ever was. I just think he loves the art of fighting, and it's a fame tour.
There's nobody does it better than him.
There's no one, I don't believe there's anyone that will ever do it as well as him. In terms of what we're talking, there's definitely better fighters, undoubtedly. But a showman, there's no one better.
What about the wee McGregor men that come out of the woodwork? These wee men are now fighting in MMA and they talk like McGregor and sound like
that. I know
the Strabama.
Well, uncomfortable, isn't it? It's the type of thing you watch, and you know.
The problem is, I don't genuinely believe that they know they're completely doing that. You know.
Oh. No, 100%.
I think they've got so in that fixated, and they don't have a style. They don't have. See, it's a very calculated, clever thing too. He's obviously very quick witted. The quick wittedness, you know, can you wrestle? I'll wrestle my fucking balls across you. You know, the quick wittedness is obviously very much there and thing. But these guys didn't have their style. And like, I don't care what anyone says, when you see a Strabane man talking with a Dublin accent, it's just weird and cringy and uncomfortable. I hope I don't fucking meet him in the night.
Do you find it funny though?
Cringy. You find it cringy.
It makes the hairs in my neck stand up. Like it's, you know.
But there is serious talent coming through now in local, and like we're gonna have so many more Northern Irishmen, in the UFC, and you know, in
The scene is real at the minute. Like it's, you know, it's as good as it's ever been. I think we're probably on the brink of 4 or 5 getting signed to the UFC. Like, and you know, this time next year we could be in a hell of a different conversation about
who do you see? Who do you see from here going in?
I mean, myself and Paul will be there, and you know, there's boys that are just a wee bit earlier at the minute, but in a year, like, a lot can change in a year. Like, there's, you know, the boys from down south are doing fantastic stuff. I mean, Connor brought a few of them in the Ultimate Fighter. I don't really know if they'll be there, but like there's people that have the opportunity to win 2 or 3 fights, and everything changes. Like, it's but me and Paul Hughes will be are the next front runners at the minute. We're the ones who should be there. Like, we both Cage Warriors title, Kaelin, the Don, as you talked about, he's fighting for the title here in Rome. He's another cert that should be there. So, you know, the Irish are doing well, and
the Cage Wars, the actual setup has become so much better. It's become, like, I know we used to say, you know, it's a feeding step, and it used to be, but the shows and productions are
unbelievable. Like, yeah. You know, and you know, Cage Wars look after me. Like, you know, a lot of people like, oh, Cage Wars is this and that. Like, Cage Wars have been very good to me. Like, yeah. I can't sit here and say a bad thing about them, and you know, it's like any promotion, they're a business too. And yeah. People don't realize, a lot of people think fighters get into fighters and they're the most entitled people ever. Like, I trained with a lot of entitled people over the years, and you know, people just feel like these promotions should be giving you 50 grand to sell 5 tickets on a Saturday in Dublin. Like, it's just not how life works. Like, you need to bring to the party as well. You know, it's not enough to sit at the table, you have to bring to the table. And that's the way I look at it. Like, Cage Wars been good to me.
Yeah. See the UFC then, what sort of money would you be?
Yeah, so actually, you know what, I heard a really funny podcast with Paul Redmond, and this is true. Like, all UFC pay is public information, so like me saying anything isn't like, it's not a secret. Yeah. Anyway, like Paul Redmond and myself, we'll use myself. Like, I get 12 grand for my first UFC fight, you lose 20% straight away to your manager, you lose 10-15% to your gym, tax number two, like, before we talk about it, we're already 60% down. Like, a 12 grand fight, which was in dollars, so convert that to 10, probably leave them a 3 grand from 12 grand. Do you know what I mean? But people like look at these like UFC payouts and be like, oh, flip, your man Reese is coming home with 12 grand there for, and he got hammered for 90 seconds when I fought Shamayev. It's not like you're 3.5 grand to get hammered for 90 seconds.
It's the long game.
It's a long game, and you know, you need to be like, it's just like anything in life though, like, you know, just because you're making that money on the bottom line doesn't mean that's really the real bottom line number. Like, you know, it's fighting's such a game. There's so many hidden percentages.
But any business, people only see one full number. They don't see, like, even if you're a gym, they're like, oh, Jesus, oh, he's making this. And you're like, yeah, well, did you see the lights on? Did you feel the heat? Did you see the insurance? You know, before you're even in the door.
Like, people go in the gym and, you know, what's the membership? What's this? And how many people? Oh, the times, flip, your boy's making...
I get that with tickets and competitions. Like, quick math, geez, you made that. And I'm like, this is why you don't do business.
Yeah, and you know what? Like, I mean, being naive, I'm sure there's a time I don't. Like, of course there was, you know. But I mean, you soon learn.
I think once you go into your own business, then you don't actually even look at other things the same. You start realizing, you're like, yeah, well, I wonder what goes with that for that.
Totally. Like, you know, the amount of people go, your man does well. It's like, maybe. Like,
but maybe so. He does. As Sean said, the money's like, and I'd say that's why when you seen Meatball Molly in her first fight and she got fight of the night, that's 50 grand. Like, that, you know, that was a big, people were like, oh, she was so happy to get fight of the night. And I was like, she was happy because there's bills being paid now. You know,
you're. And even that 50 grand, like, I don't know, where does she want it? If she won it in Vegas, like, she might have got 20 of it.
The taxes?
100%. Vegas is, that, I think, I think Vegas is 30%. So when I fought Murano the second time, I made even less money because Vegas. So when I fought in Abu Dhabi Dubai, like it was grand. I paid tax and home. It was 20%, of course. But when you fought in Vegas, they get their one.
Can't even do the old double, like, you know.
Do the double.
It's hard to hard to say to tell HMRC, I wasn't boxing there, and you on the TV like
Dana White doesn't do cash apparently. Yeah.
So look, it's not the first fight. Mm-hmm. It's the deals and the promotions and the exposure.
The things that go along with it.
Because
you know,
you look at it like Paddy Pimble, he's blew up like,
mm-hmm.
yeah. And like, let's be very honest here about it, because I love it and I actually love Paddy the way he goes on. But let's be very honest about it. It's not because of his fighting.
It's definitely not because of his fighting.
No, and like, I don't know, but I think that's the more people watch fighting and then they watch it, it's not from his fighting. It's just from the showman and the style of the way he fights and the way he talks. And
Paddy's a Marmite character for sure, but he's smart too. You know, it's definitely not because of the fighting.
Like, he's made £1 million already from...
Oh,
from
for sure. He's got £1 million sponsorship deals and stuff.
That's right. With Barstool, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah, opening gyms. And I'm pretty sure he's opening gyms in America and stuff, from what I hear anyway. But he's doing fantastic, you know.
But, like, there's another hype train, right? And UFC are very cute in how they do this. You say they're the best to go to the time. They'll still not do this. They'll yeah. not go straight into... Because when you know they might not win,
mm-hmm.
let's not go that road.
But then it's funny because there's a guy in the welterweight division in the UFC, and his name's Shavkat. I'm not going to try his second name, but he's from Kazakhstan, and he's 16 or 17 and 0. But he's he doesn't talk English,
yeah.
doesn't sell if it, doesn't slavery, can't, he doesn't talk English. And like, he fights the best, and he has since he got in maybe at 11, 12 and 0, and he's been fighting killers and still beating them. But then you have the other ones that come in that are loud, like speak English, slabber a lot, and he fights not the best, you yeah. know what I mean? So the best, the real best, do fight the best, but the best show ponies don't fight the best.
Yeah,
that's probably how I would describe it.
You know, I see we're trying to get shade out of you. We like it. We're, you know, you're not that sort of guy, but and I love to see people from here doing so well and out in that stage, and I can't wait to hear in the UFC. So me and John tell the wives, look, we gotta go because we made the man the promise in the show.
That's it. You made the promise. You can't break it.
But What would be the dream fight for you?
Dream fight?
And where? Because you've done home now and you don't have to be loyal anymore. So
you know, like, I think just, I want, like, a Vegas, the T-Mobile, you know, massive fight, like, you know, a big... It's weird, like, the division's changing so fast, like, you know... there's not really a person that I can be like... You know, I mean, whoever had the belt at the time would be the dream fight, of course, but like, you know, years ago you had your Diaz's, your Carlos Condit's, the Cerrone's, all them were what people would have called legend fights. They're not really there no more. Like, it's kind of, it's a bit different at the minute. So really, whoever has the, I hate that answer when people say it, but it's probably whoever has the belt at the time would be my dream fight.
You get the phone call now, championship fight in UFC, in the state, it's not Staples anymore, it's the T-Mobile, whatever it is. Are you there?
How do you say no?
Oh, but my...
Do you know what I mean? How do you say no? Away. Like, Leon Edwards is a monster and it would not be an easy fight by any means. I don't think there's a man in the world that beats him at the minute, but I mean, I would take a stab on it. I couldn't have a go anyway, you know, it's, I definitely would. But that, like, you know, there's fighters and there's, you know, a lot of people talk the talk, but it's like, if the phone rang now, would you get up and go? Like,
We've had this conversation, Sean, haven't we? That what we found with people that have been successful and done things is when the phone rang, they said yes.
Mm-hmm.
We were saying this about Emma going out, and we were saying this about young Lee going out. Like, what happens is people don't realise they've missed opportunities in their life. People, you know, when they get sore about things, they don't realise that you got the call somewhere along the line, but you didn't take it. Mm-hmm. You didn't.
Be hard to swallow. What is that? There's that good quote about, you know, if you think the cost of something, but the bill of regret is much more, you know. You don't want to regret a thing, you know, and even if that does mean that you have to come up short a few times, you know, eventually the path will always straighten, you know, and yeah, like, I mean, I just couldn't live with myself if I missed an opportunity like that. I really couldn't.
If they come back round welterweight in that fight that Brandon was in, happy enough to take that too.
Well, then the different promotion?
All right. What is it,
PFL.
PFL.
Jake right. Paul now owns a share in it, so he's right. doing really interesting stuff with that. I'll take a fight against him. I think, you know what, as long as it didn't tarnish, like, I still want to fight for the elite organisation. Like, yeah. PFL's not the best in the world.
Yeah.
Definitely has probably the best money. You know, I'm that's me effectively saying I'll turn down £1 million to yeah. go back to the UFC and probably fight for, 18 and 18, or, you know,
yeah,
it's mad. But like, it's just not money. It's just not money is just not my motivator.
Because to be honest with you, if it was the sole motivating factor, when you're in on a cold night, say you go to night,
not be fighting. Like, if money was my thing, like,
you just roll out of it. Like, you say, fuck that, you know.
Like, Jim, when we run a gym, like, imagine I didn't train, you know, 25, 30 hours a week, and I put an extra 25 to 30 hours in the gym, you know, flip me, like, yeah, I'd probably make decent dough. But like, it's just not my driver of success. It's all for legacy.
You know what I loved about it? See the title fight? It was 1 million or 50 grand.
Bit like, of contrast on it.
You ain't tapping. You are fucking crawling for that. Like.
And he's fighting again now. They're starting the next one. Like, he'll win it again.
Oh, that's right. They're going to
win it again.
But your body would need to stand up, you know.
And they're quick fights. Like,
that's what I mean.
They have like five fights in the space of...
It's a 6-week turnaround or something.
Flipping head, you know, you need £1 million for it.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's put it this way: you get your last fight, you couldn't, even if you won, you couldn't keep in the thing. You know, you wouldn't
can,
have been
can train for 4 months.
No, you'd be fucked. Well, if you have anything more there, Sean, I have grilled.
Just can't wait to go and watch you now in the UFC. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
I think we need to try and like nail some. I know it's sold out, but you know, you'll always get some boys and get a couple of tickets for Dublin.
Dublin, you know what, Dublin, you know, we're a big talk at the minute, what's the walkout tune's going to be? So if you have any recommendations, you can fire them.
TNT, boys. That's what I walked out to on my white collar successful.
Did you do white collar?
I did indeed.
What happened?
Come second as well.
Yeah, absolutely. <did not. laughs> Punched ahead of him. And I hope he's listening.
You get a hammer?
I'll go do a rematch.
What was the crack? Or
it was for a local. Like, remember? Do you remember the time all the football clubs were doing it, and they were all raising money, and yeah, and then me and the guy fought, and he played for the team, so they gave him a draw. But do you know what happened? You know what happened too.
They always do them things as a draw, don't they?
But actually, you know what? It was a good and nice crack, and I'm only joking. But
but you will fight him again if need.
100%. I would do one, no bother.
Yeah, we run it, so I'll get you a place on it.
Give me.
You will not see this man in the ring ever again. You mark my words.
Well, I've made him an offer, so.
On camera, right now. I love. Do you know what I like about boxing? And I love boxing, and I'm shite at it and thing, but do you know what I loved about it? And it very much reminded me of rugby. I remember when I went first play rugby when I was young, and I used to love testing myself. I used to always think before a game, you'll chicken out or something, you'll not do, you know, you'll not put the hit in, you'll not, you know, when you get met one-on-one, there a big man come down your line, you ain't going to take him out. And then you put yourself in that position, there's nowhere to hide, and you genuinely, all the way up until it, and it's maybe the same as rallying, we come to big jumps and I don't lift, but all before my head, I told you this before my head, I think I'm going to go the other road. Mm-hmm. And then when the chips are actually down and you do go for it and you put the fucking shoulder in, or you're fighting and you bite down and go for it, as opposed to there's nowhere to go. Mm-hmm. I love and it's a real perverse pleasure of putting yourself in a position where you are testing it's not even your mentality, it's what's in you. You're finding out, is it fight or flight? It's in you, you know, where's your grit? And that's what I loved about it. And no matter if you're good at it or not, I always said this: if somebody at one point in their life takes, whether it's white collar, you fought, and obviously not to, but you will never disrespect anybody that puts their in between the ropes or in the cage, because if you have the balls to do that, there's a certain grit in you anyway.
100%, and see that like that. I always, there's this like second or like 2 to 5 second window in a fight where like nobody's gonna, who's gonna throw first. And it's that feeling of like, oh, flip, you go first. You know, I'll go first. But having my experience, I go first. But fight or flight's a real thing. And once, like, you have to appreciate it. You have to respect anyone that doesn't.
Because, but I don't know if that was just the way I felt about it. But when you know, there's a serious buzz from that itself.
Oh, for sure.
That you've tested, you've really went to that deep place to find out what is it about. And you learn something about yourself, whether mm-hmm. you're fucking blowing and you're like, you know, it's even in training, and I think this comes in training. I've seen ones in this training. Do you ever see when you're training or you're doing something? Obviously, I don't look like much of training now, but back then when I was training, and you would go on and do that, and you'd mm-hmm. be like, I remember one time, wasn't it me and you, and my arm just gave out by, and the dumbbell absolutely emptied me.
Yeah.
But You went past most people. 99.9% of people will stop well before that. Their mind would have told them that that's no more. Mm-hmm. But you've gone past where you're actually physically capable, and you pushed and pushed and pushed till actually you're like, fuck, I didn't never have thought that could happen. All of a sudden the arm gave out and bang, busted.
You know what, the mind's a funny thing. I remember being a kid and had a fight or 16, 17, had a fight lined up, and you're walking up the road and a car was driving, and you know, you see the old lamppost, and you're like, right, if I don't beat that car to that lamppost, I'm going to lose my fight. Or like doing stuff like,
my family's going to die if I don't run down.
Does everybody do that?
I think so.
I used to do like throw things at light switches, being like, if that light doesn't go off, I lose the fight and stuff. And I still do it in the sauna. Like, you know, I try and guess the time, and if I get it wrong, I punish myself and sit in for an extra 5 minutes. So it's like, this is me, like, as in like last month done this. So
I actually think that's true. Or you know,
I'm like playing having a little conversation with myself.
But no, look, Reese, first and foremost, we want to thank you for coming up. I really enjoyed it. I love martial arts, and everyone's behind you 100%, and can't wait to see you in the UFC.
Appreciate it.
And get my excuse to go back to the UFC. I don't know. I'm torn now. I don't know now. Obviously, UFC can come back to New York. New York is a deadly spot for the Madison Square Garden. It's bound to be a spot, but like Abu Dhabi's making a real go of putting up.
They're back in October, so who knows?
Look, listen, bit of winter sun, I'm 100%. My birthday's in October, the worlds are aligning.
You're for it. All for you, it'll be made for you.
Reese, thanks very much. Hey,
unreal, thank you so much.
Been a pleasure.
Thank you.